How's everyone doing this morning? Let's all stand.
Who breaks the power? is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Anybody thankful for God's amazing grace in your life? Amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Lord, we thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you for your presence in this place. Well, God bless you. Welcome to Sunday morning service. Are you glad to be here this morning? Amen. Just a couple quick announcements, and then we'll move forward. Don't forget Monday night prayer, 7 o'clock. Let's keep fueling the fire. Come on now. Amen. Look at someone and say, come on now. Wednesday night life group, 7 o'clock. We're starting a new series, a four-week series, this Wednesday, 7 o'clock. So let's get the word out. Let's invite somebody. Taking responsibility for your life. How about this? It's time to stop the blaming, the finger pointing, and making excuses, and be responsible. Amen. That's a good one. A lot of people are stuck and not fulfilling their purpose and their destiny because of that. It's everybody else's fault. The devil is a liar. Amen. America's like, that's right. It's everybody's fault. Amen. But that's for real. So I want to encourage you to take part of that four-week course. And I believe it's going to bless you. You're going to get a lot of knowledge, understanding to apply so you can move forward and be a blessing the way God created you to be. Amen. Praise the Lord. And be free from all that stuff. I said to be free from all that stuff. Amen. So that's Wednesday. And then real quick, Jeff, would you come up here real quickly? Many of you, as you're walking, I want to say thank you for everybody that has brought their little caps from the water bottles, like, you know, those the caps. I don't know if you saw on the way in. And for some, you've read, and it's like on the little bucket there, but I really want to get the, so for the ones that haven't taken the time or haven't been able to read that, what we're doing and how it's benefiting people, okay? So Jeff, why don't you let us know what we're doing here?
Okay. Hey, everybody. I usually come to Saturday night, so this is all new to me coming tonight today, and I'm getting a lot of funny looks and stuff, but you know what?
Yeah, what are you doing here?
It's all about Jesus Christ.
Amen, amen.
So, about a month ago or so, my daughter, she teaches 7th grade history, social studies at a school, a junior high in East Mesa. And she texted me. She says, Dad, you got to start collecting bottle caps. And I said, well, that does make a lot of sense. But what they're doing is they're having a contest in the school that each one of the home rooms are collecting bottle caps, and somehow they send them to a organization in Mexico, and they turn it into free chemotherapy for cancer patients. And so they're doing that, and they're collecting them, and then they have a contest every month, and then the home room that has the most every month wins donuts. And praise God, my daughter, she texted me Friday and she said, we won. So, and it's all because, and if I could just talk for just a couple minutes. And it's not about the bottle caps. I got to be honest with you, okay? We want to collect the bottle caps because that's what it's all, that's the end product is the bottle caps. And then to get the chemotherapy for the cancer patients. But what it comes right down to is what they're doing is they're creating a fellowship. They're creating relationships amongst the kids because they've got a goal set for them. And what Pastor preaches and talks to us about is creating that relationship, that fellowship with Jesus Christ. And that's what they're doing. Unbeknownst to some of those kids, this is what they're doing. They're creating those relationships. They're creating the fellowship. And that's what it's all about here in the church. It's about, you know, you guys getting together, putting it in that container at the house, bringing it here, remembering that you're serving somebody else selflessly, and you're bringing that forward to them. Somebody you don't even know is going to benefit from you drinking that bottle of water, saving that cap, thinking about it, and praying upon it so that you can serve somebody else and possibly save their life. So it's not just about the bottle cap. It's about serving, creating fellowship and serving our most wondrous, our glorious, our just the God that we serve and the Jesus Christ that he gave to us to save us from our sins. So just go forward, do that. We'll be doing this for the rest of the year. And if you just want to turn them in over there, we'll be collecting them on a monthly basis. So praise God and be blessed.
Thank you, Jeff. Praise the Lord. And let's keep him in prayer. For some know, some don't. He's actually on our board here at the church and also our CPA here at the church. And also at Apache Junction, he's a councilman at Apache Junction. So he's got a lot going on, and God is using him in a great way and using him in an arena to shine for Jesus in government. Amen. So, and that's how, you know, I was at a gathering for Primus University where I graduated last year from, and I had an opportunity to speak on Thursday. And one of the speakers that was there was talking about we need to get into the arena where the players are at. In other words, where the players meaning the people that are making the decisions. We need to start getting into those places and those platforms because that's where the changes take place. We need Jesus in those places. So God is using Jeff in those places. Amen. So praise the Lord. Because it's not about being inside the four walls. It's about taking it outside the four walls because that's where the need is. Amen. So God bless you, Jeff, for all you do. And let's keep him in prayer. Amen. Praise God. Amen. So why don't we do this at this time? Why don't we're going to take the offering at this time, and then we'll move forward in the service. So tomorrow I leave for India. So please be in prayer. Sheila, why don't you come up here so you can pray for the offering. I want you to pray for the offering. And my wife Sheila is wearing, last time I was in India, this is what I brought her back from India. So she's wearing this symbolically. Why are you wearing it again? Because I'm leaving it out, right?
Well, yeah, but it fits me now. He brought it back. You know, the reason why I didn't go to India is because I was like 6 weeks pregnant. So we're using wisdom, even though I was like, we can go. And they're like, okay, but then there's wisdom, Sheila. So then he brought me back all these gifts. Well, nothing fit me at that point. And so I was like, well, I'll get in it at some point. So then today I was thinking, what to wear? And I was like, oh, I've been wanting to wear this with the jewelry.
The jewelry, there it is. Right? From India.
So I put it on and it actually fit me. So I was like, well, praise the Lord. I was like, I'm excited. So I love this outfit. I fit in it now. So, and because you're going to India. So
and I'm going to India by the grace of God. Amen. So today, as we take this offering, it's the final offering before we go to India. And I, like I said, I want to be a blessing as a church here for the church that's there. Amen. And they're putting together all these meetings, and they got all these people coming, and they got media. They got all, God willing, I'm going to be able to come back with all those services, like three of them recorded. So they got a whole team, media team. So there's just a lot of stuff that they're putting together, singers that are coming in. And so I want to be able to go and leave something there and be a blessing. Amen. So as we take this offering, please, as many have been praying, this is it. This is the one before we leave. So whatever we calculate, and then I'm gonna take it with me when I go tomorrow. Okay. So be in prayer, and like I said before, just be obedient. Amen. And if you are sowing into the trip to India, just put on your check India or on your offering envelope India, and we'll make sure that that's where that's gonna go. Praise the Lord. Mama's coming. Hold on, baby. Praise the Lord. Okay. Mama's coming. Okay. Okay. Oh. She woke up this morning, and Sheila was getting ready, and I was right next to her in the bed, and I looked at her, and the first word, and she says, Mama? I go, Dada. And then she goes, true story. Then she goes, Mama? And I go, Dada. And then she goes, Mama. And I go, no, Dada. And then she goes, Dada. Praise the Lord. Amen. True story. Praise God. So, again, I want to thank everybody for the ones that have already given to the trip. And I've been so encouraged. And even right before service, I just got really encouraged by someone that just blessed the family and also for the trip to India. And I want to let you know that that meant a lot. That really encouraged me. Amen. And especially about thinking about my family and Sheila and baby Grace. Amen. So God bless you for that. Amen. And praise the Lord. So are you ready to give? Okay, praise God. Sheila, ready to pray? Look at somebody. Look at Sheila and look at her and say, make it a real good one. Amen.
All right, well, my flesh is going to die, so Holy Spirit, rise up in the name of Jesus. I don't want to say the prayer. Holy Spirit, I want you to say the prayer, and I just thank you, Jesus. Everybody, raise your offering, your tithes up to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because this is for you. We are sowing into fertile ground, and we just thank you, Jesus, for every single soul that is here, every heart that is here, God, and we just pray right now for this tithes and these offerings for your kingdom, for souls for your kingdom, and also for India, God, for money to be able to go to India, because we, God, first and foremost, we're taking care of our background, our backyard, our background, our area here, God. We're taking care of the city that we are in, that we've been called to, the vision here, God. But then also, we are sending it to all over the world. And this part of the world is going to be India. So we just thank you, Jesus, for a harvest of souls to come in, God, that the people that are coming, that they will hear, they will just know, because there you don't announce it. It's like people just know. So we just pray for even increase in the number of souls that are going to be there and that are going to be saved for your glory. Even people that their intentions weren't pure, God, but you get a hold of them because your fire and your anointing get a hold of them, and they're going to be significant people in the kingdom of God to bring even more people in. So we just thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. And we thank you, God, that you get all the glory, all the honor, and the praise. I pray for protection over every single person there as they're getting ready, and also over my husband in the name of Jesus. I thank you for my precious husband, for his heart, for the hurting, the poor, the addicted, the afflicted, and the lost, God. I thank you, Lord, that you are protecting him. And I thank you, Lord, that it's going to be such a mighty mission. A mighty mission for your glory, Lord. I thank you for that. And I thank you, Jesus, that that every person that was here today, those that came for the first time, we just ask that you break down the hardened walls on their hearts, and that soften their heart, God, that they can receive your holy word today, that they can leave with pep in their step, they can leave with the fire and the anointing, salvation, and that they can go to their family members or go out to eat, and they spread it. They spread the love of you, Jesus, wherever they go today, Lord God. I just thank you for today. We seal this with your precious blood in Jesus' name, and everyone says amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Amen. So thank you. Praise the Lord. And then I'll be back the following, leave Monday, so I'll be back not this coming up weekend, but the following weekend. I'll get back on Friday night, and so please keep me in prayer. And then next weekend, Saturday night, Pastor Tony will be sharing the word, and then on Sunday morning, Chaplain Lee is going to be sharing the word. Do you guys have any idea is there anything? Can you give us a little tidbit or something? Chaplain Lee? Well, why don't you come up just for a second. Yeah, he's like, oh, come on, I don't have to speak until next week. Amen. Amen. So is that what you're gonna leave him with? Give a little something, amen.
Wait on the Spirit. See, I'll be preaching between now and then, so it could change. Anything could happen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. You're not ready. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. So I know it's going to be a blessing. So so invite people this coming up weekend, and let's get people in the house of the Lord, in the presence of God, because it's in his presence that lives are changed. People are healed, delivered, and set free. So let's make sure that we're being a blessing and making ourselves available throughout the week. Amen. Praise God. And taking it outside the four walls, that we're not looking at the same faces every Sunday or every Saturday or every Wednesday or every Monday. Praise God. We should be seeing new faces all the time. If we're not seeing new faces coming in and being impacted by the kingdom of God, we're not an effective church. We're a clique and we're a club. Look at somebody and say, we're not a clique and we're not a club. I mean, that's real. Amen. Same people 5 years down the road. And it's like, man, it's 5 years and it's the same people. one new person in 5 years. Look at some and say, no, that's not us. A healthy church is always reproducing, because anything that has life reproduces. Amen? Praise the Lord. So are we done with the offering? Yeah, praise God. So why don't we just stand to our feet? What we're going to do is we're going to worship the Lord for a few minutes here, prepare our hearts for the word, and then we're going to finish with communion today. Amen? Praise God. God bless you. Somebody hallelujah. Shout hallelujah in this place.
Hallelujah. You conquer the grave. You are alive, Jesus.
No matter where you're at here today and what you're going through, it's not too late and it's not bigger than God. I said it's not too late. It'd be too late if you weren't breathing. It's not too late. And it's not bigger than God. I want to encourage you here this morning to call upon His name. The one that opened up the Red Sea. The one that was with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. The one that says to you and me here this morning, turn to me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you will honor me. Not I might, not I'll think about it. It says, turn to me. Not when everything's going good, but in your mess, in your circumstances, right where you're at, the thing you're dealing with, the thing that seems impossible, the thing that you're about to lose your mind over. God says, turn to me in that time of trouble. And not I might, but I will deliver you and you will honor me. I want to encourage you to call upon His name, to follow Him with all your heart. And trust Him from this day forward. And watch what He'll do. Don't you dare give up. Don't you dare give up. God loves you. He hasn't left you. He hasn't forsaken you. But God has sent me here this morning to tell you that He hasn't forsaken you, that He loves you. And His hands of grace and His hands of mercy are stretching out here today, saying, come home, son. Come home, daughter. Let me help you. We serve the God of turnaround. We serve the God that removes mountains. We serve the God of restoration. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's still restoring. He's still healing. He's still delivering. He's still setting the captives free. There's hope here this morning. Amen. Shall I believe it? Don't you dare give up. For you're seated in the presence of the Lord. Look at someone and say, don't you dare give up. God hasn't given up on you. 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 Look at someone and say, God hasn't given up on you. Amen. God hasn't given up on you. And just the idea, the thought that you want to give up prophesies how great the blessing is on the other side. The thought, the idea that you want to give up at this point in your life is prophetic. Your giving up is prophetic about the greatness and the breakthrough that's about to take place in your life. As I've said many times, the idea of wanting to give up lets you know, lets everybody else know, prophesies to the world that you have something to give up. That God has a plan. How can I say I want to give up on something if you don't have something to give up? What are you giving up on? So you can't say I give up on whatever the situation is if you don't have something to give up on. So be encouraged this morning. Lift up your head this morning. Straighten up your back this morning. God has a plan. God has a purpose. God is still with you. And all things work together for the good for those who love God and are called according to His purpose. And move forward with the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit. And be the champion that God's called you to be. Be the voice that God's called you to be. Be the world changer in your world that God's called you to be. Shall ya? Last night, God just, the Spirit of God was leading me and brought up a topic as a reminder also. And I started to share last night, and the message was, I was just being led by the Spirit, and I was just putting it together as God was giving it to me last night. And I want to revisit it for a moment here this morning. The Bible says in James chapter 5, verse 16, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. This speaks about one of the weapons that God has given us to be successful on this earth for His glory. It speaks about a weapon that God has given us so we can be effective and productive and to affect the people around us for the glory of God. The weapon of prayer that is being not used in the church today. The Bible says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal the land. Which lets us know the reason why we're where we're at today in our country is because the church is not praying. Can we be real? And here in Ephesians, in James chapter 5, verse 16, God says that the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much, or powerful and effective. God has given us this weapon so when we pray, we can change the atmosphere around us. When we pray, we can speak those things that are not as though they are. When we pray and pick up the word of God and speak the word of God, amen, to bring healing, to bring restoration, to bring a move of God and bring healing of the land, healing for our nation, healing for our families, healing for our neighborhoods, healing for our cities. Prayer. And Jesus, in Mark chapter 1, verse 35, gives us an example to follow. Now, this is Jesus, God himself. Now, he is fully God, fully human. Emmanuel, God with us. And we see here in Mark chapter 1, verse 35, the Bible says that very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. This wasn't once in a while. This was consistent in his life on this earth that pushed him and propelled him to succeed on the mission and the assignment that he was called to, which was the cross and the resurrection. Spend time with the Father to receive instructions for the day, power for the day, fuel for the day. Spend time with the Father before he went forth during that day. And we know that he was successful and accomplished the mission because here we are today, amen, lifting up his name. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. And what we see here is two things that are taking place that all of us, some need to be reminded, some need to get started once. Are you with me? Amen. It speaks about two things that we see here that are happening, a time and a place. A time and a place where he prayed. He got up in the morning. It speaks of, while it was still dark, of a time. And it also speaks of a place, a solitary place. Two things are operating here that he was consistent with that made him effective in the ministry that he was called to. We are trying to do ministry. We are trying to make decisions daily without having a time and a place with him. And we're making decisions not with his wisdom, but our wisdom. We're coming up short, and many of us want to give up sometimes because we don't have the power and the strength. And we get weary and tired because the truth be told is we don't have that time and a place consistently, which is causing us to do the work or what we're doing in our own strength because we're making decisions on our own in the name of Jesus. Come on now. The Lord's leading me. How do you know the Lord's leading you when you didn't even talk to him? Oh, come on now. Amen. That ain't the Lord. I mean, so many times, I'm like, what are you talking about? Amen. And we don't. So a time and a place. So I want to encourage us here. And the Lord was reminding me last night, you need to get back to the time and the place. To set a time. And of course, he gives us a model here before the day starts. It's probably the best time before the busyness starts. in a place that's quiet, a place that you can spend time and hear from God and talk to God and get filled up and gain the wisdom that you need for the day and the strength that we need for the day, amen? The fire that we need for the day, amen? I mean, because we have a church today that's saying a lot of things in Jesus' name and there's no power behind it. How can there be power when we are not consistently visiting our time and place with Him? Because when we are faithful to a time and a place, when we leave that time and place, we speak like Him. We act like Him. We walk like Him. And when we speak His word, He confirms with signs and wonders. When we walk into rooms and places and work and wherever it might be, the atmosphere is shifted because we've been spending time with Him, because we just left time and place. So now when we walk in there, people know there's something different with you. When we go to work, when we go places, do people know and see the difference, feel the difference? The atmosphere in the places we go to should not be affecting us, but we should be affecting the atmosphere of the place that we go to. We're offended so easily because we're still operating with our mind and in the flesh. So we hold on to offenses. We get upset easily. We have to get the last word in. There's no joy. There's no peace. How can there be peace in your day? How can there be joy in the day? How can you forgive on that day if you haven't been with Him, with time and place? Because the Bible says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control, you know, when you're driving and someone cuts in or doesn't let you come in. I had a moment just the other day. Maybe that's why the Lord brought this message up last night. You know, sometimes where things happen, this is a good test to know if you've been faithful and consistent with your time and place, because when someone cuts in on you, or like the other day, I was trying to get out of a parking lot, and it's like there's just a little, and I'm trying to, and the person's seeing me, and there's traffic, they're not going anywhere. And then when the light changes, and I'm trying to get in there, this person just kept on going, and then just for a moment, you know, I went a little further, amen. And then they start, anyway, we'll just leave that. And then they went, and then the other person lets me in, and then that person get behind another car, and you know, when they're on their tail, and just they it's like, where are you going? But see, when you've been in time and a place, you're just smiling. Really, when you've been time and place, you come out of that and you're like, man, Lord, bless them, Lord, help them, Lord, whatever they're going through, whatever is going on in their lives, Lord, if they don't know you, that they'll come in a relationship. But when you've been in the time and a place, you got self-control. Your language is God's language. You're not trying to get the last word in. You got joy. You got the peace of God because it's a fruit of the Spirit, a byproduct of Him, and you're checking in with Him. So now you're walking out, and you got peace in the midst of the storm. You got joy during that day. And people recognize it. You don't just have joy or a smile just in church.
And this is where we're failing. We've got the smile in church, but do we have the smile Monday through Friday? Our behavior. Because when you feed on spending time with Him, then you're able to, that's how you overcome and stay victorious over addiction. Because whatever you feed on grows, whatever you starve dies. Because when you have a time and a place, and you have to have that place needs to be a quiet place. Away from the phones, away from Facebook, away from the television, away from the noise, away from the busyness. And when you're spending time with Him, you're getting His mind, you're getting His heart, and that grows. So it's not a matter of as much as like, I got to stop this and I got to quit this, as much as I just have to have a time and a place. And not just once a week, but every day. Because when I have a time and a place, then I have the peace of God. I don't need something else or to fulfill that area in my life. Because He's fulfilling it. And this is where we're coming up short. People aren't finishing ministries and churches and are not fulfilling their assignment or finishing their assignment because they started off with a time and a place, but then later on, the ministry and the work has become the relationship instead of the time and place. And without a time and a place, because He's going to give us the power and the fuel and the wisdom to be effective, so we don't finish. People quit. People give in. People wander off because they're not consistent with a solitary place as Jesus sets the example and that time of prayer. Because that's where it happens. That's where we get the strength. That's where we get the wisdom. That's where we're able to go forth and get the instructions for the day, for the next day, the following day, as we continue to meet Him in that time and that place. Otherwise, who's leading us? Who's guiding us? Who's making the decisions? Are we checking in with Him? And that's why we have a church that's full of people offended all the time. How can we be offended? Because God said offenses will come. How can we get so easily offended all the time if you're meeting with Him every morning? Because then you're looking at the person and you're seeing him from God's eyes, God's point of view, God's heart. So you're able to forgive. You're able to love them where they're at. You don't get bitter, you don't get angry, you let it go, and what you actually do, you're praying for them. A lot of ministry, a lot of assignments in the name of Jesus, but no power. It's just programs. And lives are walking in and walking out the same way. Just going through the motions. Look at someone and say, I don't want to be like that. And we forget the one that saved us and helped us. Time and a place. And I want to encourage you here this morning. Or to get back to if you had that place. To get back to that place. Because that's the key to finishing strong. That's the key to fulfilling your purpose. That's the key to this church fulfilling its assignment. I said last night, the Lord just dropped this in my spirit. I was thinking about work back in the day when I used to work at the airport. You know, and you got to be aggressive about it. You got to be aggressive about the time and the place. We do things consistently every day, and when you think about when you get up in the morning to go to work, you know, and you get up at a certain time. If you have it's a regular routine. You get up, you go to work, certain time, come home, and you do that every day, whatever those days are that you work. And sometimes you get up and you're tired, but you still do it. Amen.
Now, what happens when you don't do it? Well, I remember when I'd be late for work, or some people would not even show up to work. Well, at work, there was when you didn't show up, for whatever the reason might be, it'd go under as a no-show. Now, you wouldn't get fired for one no-show, but you get written up, and it's on your record. And if you do it continually, no-show, no-show, or you have a certain amount of being late coming to church. Praise the Lord. Coming to church. Also, praise the Lord. Amen. But think about this. If you're late at a certain point, you'll lose your job. They fire you. They release you from your position because of your inconsistency of showing up where you're supposed to be, time and a place. So if you're not getting up at a certain time and going to a certain place to work, right, and a certain time, eventually you'll get fired. When you get fired, think about it, and you lose your job, that job for most of us was providing to take care of your bills, your mortgage, your rent, your insurance, your food, right? So now, watch this, because I'm not consistent with my time and place, getting up at a certain time and getting there on time and being at that place where I'm supposed to be, the effects of it now is I've lost my job, and now I don't have that income coming in. Now I'm stressed because I'm trying to figure out how am I going to pay my bills. So now it's affecting everything that's connected to me. And then when I go look for another job, I can't even refer back to the old job because the old job would let the new job that you're trying to get, well, he wasn't here. He was always late and he never showed up. So now it's even affecting my future job because I can't even use my past job because I didn't leave that place the right way because I was so inconsistent. So now it's affecting my future employment. Time and a place. In the spirit, look at someone say, think about it. When we don't have a consistent meeting place, time and a place with God, consistently, is it not going to affect everything that's connected to us? Could this be an area that we're coming up short and we struggle during the week and we don't have peace during the week and we don't have the joy of the Lord during the week? It's the devil, it's the enemy coming against me. No time, no place has nothing to do with the devil. And we're always living defeated lives. Because we make time to be on the phone with everybody during the day. Some of us will be in conversations with people for maybe an hour on the phone. Has anybody been on the phone for an hour? Man, I can't even, after a couple minutes, I'm like, okay, I'm done. I hate talking on the phone. We go on Facebook and spend hours on Facebook. Check me out. Look at where I'm at. And Jesus is saying, how about checking me out and see where I'm at? We're on the phone for hours with people, calling people, talking to people, texting people, and God's saying, when was the last time you texted me? When was the last time you called me? When was the last time you answered my call? Woo! And then we don't understand. You think the person you're on the phone is going to pay your bill? Help you with your healing? Bring you peace? Bring you joy? Give you the grace that's necessary to do this thing? So we've made time We have place and time for everybody else. But where it counts the most and is the most important, Jesus and our relationship, we've put on the bottom of the list. And I've said, you know, I've been there many times too, where it's like, you know, and then you get busy throughout the day, and then you get home, and then you just have a quick prayer at the end. And just for time's sake, I'm not going to go to some scripture. I had some scripture in the Old Testament that talks about how they were bringing blind animals and crippled animals. And God says, would you take this? Would you receive this? And what they were doing was they were offering crippled and diseased animals instead of bringing God the best. So what we do is, instead of giving God our best to start off the day with and giving him first place, we end up the day, and what we do, we give him our leftovers. And then we don't understand why we're not successful. We don't have victory. We want to have a jump in our spirit. We don't have peace in our life. We don't have joy in our life. We can't forgive. We can't let go. We give them our leftovers. And I've been there. And even this morning, I got up this morning. I'm like, after last night, because I know God's trying to get a hold of me. He's like, if you're going to go the distance, you need to start getting back to that time and a place and spend more time with me. Not doing things in my name. I'm talking about spending time with me in relationship. Got up this morning. It was just a little bit of time. But you know what? Before I did anything, because I do, I have different ways that I just. But this morning, I got up and I went downstairs to my spot, because I only have, because, you know, Grace and Sheila have the rest of the house. Sheila's got her own room. Grace has her own room. Then we got our bedroom that, you know, that's, you know, we share and stuff like that. And then in the living room and dining room, that area, well, the dining room, there's no dining room anymore because it's her play area. So we got like a fence all the way around and all her toys and all this stuff. So every which way you turn, it's Grace and then Sheila. And then it's like, so my area is the garage. Why are you guys clapping? What does that mean? What does that mean? What does that mean? You guys are saying praise the Lord and clapping. No, that's not all right. The garage? Where's my place? Where's my room? Those days are over. I already know. I've come to grips with that. Those days are over. And I wouldn't trade it for the world. Amen. I wouldn't trade it for the world to wake up in the morning and, like I said earlier, to hear, mama, no, dada, mama, no, dada, mama, dada. Amen. Praise the Lord. You got it. It's priceless. It's priceless. So I got up this morning, went downstairs and grabbed the Bible. And I go, okay, before I pick up the phone, because sometimes I'll go and I'll talk to the Lord, but then I'm still doing stuff and, you know, I'm still busy. I'm still checking emails, and I'm like, you know, and then sometimes even a scripture will come in from somewhere, you know, and I'll read, but it's like, no, I'm going to read the word first. I'm going to say hi to the Lord first. Because you don't even realize it, right? Come on, you're thinking, Pastor, you really? Yeah, I mean, come on, let's be real. We get so busy with all the chaos, and once the day gets started, you got to get in the morning. Jesus sets a great example to find that place and that time where you can hear him. It's just you and him, for even to start off with a few minutes. And you know what? Today, even though it was just a little short little period, I'm encouraged. Because I know that God is speaking to me to build on that and don't let anything get in the way of it. Just like you have appointments during the day, you have places to be during the day, you got things to do during the day, and we're aggressive and militant about doing those things, why are we not aggressive and militant about protecting that appointment, which is the most important appointment of all? And don't let anything get in the way of it. No phone calls. And it's like I said last night, if it interrupts your time and place,
You got to protect it. If someone says, I got Super Bowl tickets and your team is in the Super Bowl. Now, of course, the Super Bowl is not in the morning like that anyway, but let's just say, I'm just using this as an example. I don't know if it's a good example, but I'm going to use it. And your time and place is being interrupted, and they say, we got two tickets for the Super Bowl, and your team's playing in it. Free hotel, free flight, we'll get you there. You're going to be in a suite. You know, we're going to put you in a box. You're going to be able to enjoy the game. You're going to be with the owner of the team that's playing. But it's going to interrupt your time and place. Are you going to sell out for the Super Bowl? Because we're doing it every day. Facebook, other people, phone, television. And like I said last night, and let me help you. If that happens to you and it interrupts your time and place, just give me the tickets. Amen. Just kidding. But we got to be militant. And you got to protect that time because it's the most important time in your day. Let me just finish this. Go to Matthew. Let me just finish. Matthew. There's so much. I got so much. I just want to stir us a little bit. Amen. And it starts with me. We need to get back to this place. We got to get back to the weapon of prayer. We're doing way too much in the name of Jesus without checking in with Jesus. And that's why we're in trouble. Big decisions. And we're making them without the wisdom of the Lord. And then we check in briefly. And then when he doesn't answer right away, we're like, okay, well, what do you do? Well, keep, you don't do nothing. You just keep on checking in until he says something. He didn't answer. Yes, he did. He said, don't do nothing. Be still and know that I'm God. Be patient. The answer might be no later on, or maybe it'll be something, or maybe it's yes later, but right now it's premature. And if you go do that right now and it's premature, you're going to have a disaster on your hand. But right now, just be still and keep on spending time with me because I'm preparing you for what I have for you in the future. So be still. I've answered you, God says. God, that's a word for somebody. God's saying, I've already answered you. God is saying to you about your situation, be still and know that I'm God. Matthew chapter 6, starting in verse 9. So here's Jesus now, a model of prayer. Let me just, he says, this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Right there, hold on, right there. Just so it's, so he's given us a little structure. So when we do meet him and we protect that and we meet him, we're not coming to him and say, well, Lord, good morning, and here's my list. Well, so somebody's saying no, but that's how we are. We come to church with the list. This is how you pray. Our Father in heaven, help you. When we wake up in the morning, we should be waking up and spending time with him and thanking him and worshiping him and lifting up his name. We should be meeting him with that time and place with no agenda, no list. It should be, Lord, thank you that I'm still alive. Lord, thank you for your amazing grace. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for not giving up on me. Thank you for covering me. Thank you for protecting me, for I should have been dead 100 times over. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for my family. Thank you for the people you brought in my life to help me get to where I'm at. Thank you, Lord God, for all the times you intercepted disaster in my life. Lord, I give you all the glory. I give you all the honor. And if you never answer a prayer in my life, it's all good with me because one moment I was on my way to hell, but because of you, I'm on my way to heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Someone shout hallelujah. That's how you start your conversation with the Creator. with a heart of thanksgiving, lifting up his awesome name, blessing his name. There's nothing worse. I said this last night. You know, when someone comes up, especially in ministry, it's like, you know, you get it, you know, in the prison, you know, there's needs, and people are going through stuff, and that's what we're here for. We want to help each other, right? But man, when you first see someone, especially when you haven't seen somebody in a while, there's nothing worse where it's like when you go up to someone, all of a sudden they just like unload on you. And it's like, and instead of saying, how are you doing or something, it's immediately, man, Chaplain Lee, all hell's breaking loose. And the cat ran away and the dog got in a fight with the neighbor's dog. And you're thinking, man, hold on a second. I just got out of the car. I haven't even gotten to my office yet. It doesn't feel good. It's not. Then if I came up to you and said, Chaplain Lee, you know what? I so appreciate what you do for the kingdom. I know it's not easy for your family. It's frontline ministry. You've been doing it for so long, and you've affected so many lives in the prison. So many lives have been transformed because of your willingness and your family and your wife together to be willing to answer the call. God bless you for all you do. So how have things been going? Then after a few months, and then usually when that happens, then the response is you don't even have to say anything about anything because that person will, because they're like, man, they're so touched. They're like, is there anything I can pray for you? How? That's how we do God, though. The one that saved us. Instead of worshiping him and praising him and thanking him, we go to him for what we can get from him. How does that feel when someone's like that towards you? But man, when you come with the heart of thanksgiving and encouragement and just, then all of a sudden, that person is touched. And then you turn around, you're like, man, what can I do for you? Is there anything I can help you with? How you been this week? You don't have to tell anybody anything because it's so rare today. No one does that. Very few. Every time someone does that to me, I'm touched. I'm encouraged. When they come and I'm like, okay, because I'm so used to like, okay, what do we need here? What's the need here? For someone to give or bless or encourage me, I'm like, I don't even know how to act. It touches me and it encourages me. It happened this morning already. Perfect timing for this trip. The words touched my heart, thought about my family. It touched me. When we worship and we enter into that time and place with him, by just saying, Lord, I don't want anything. I just want to worship you and bless you. It touches his heart. And then God turns around and says, okay, my little one. But he already knows what you need before you even ask him. So we enter in that time and place with that kind of a spirit and that kind of a heart. And watch this. Now go on to the next verse. I can't do this all today. Gosh. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. So Lord, it's not my will, it's your will. Whatever you have for today. That's a great way to live. Lord, whatever your plan is for me today, your will to be done. Not what I want, not what I'm thinking, but what are you thinking about today? And go to the next verse. And here it is. Give us today our daily bread. Watch this. The Bible says, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Give us today our daily. Watch this. I'm gonna stop here. Let me do this. Today, when you pray and you spend time with him, focus on today. Yesterday is gone. If we're going to look back at what he did for you. Look at those altars that he showed up on behalf of your life. But the rest, God, watch me, God has forgiven you. He has forgiven you as far as the east is from the west. And what we have a tendency to do is when we go pray, I'm trying to help somebody, we have a tendency to pray back to the past and ask God to forgive us for something 5 years ago. Lord, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. And God's saying, I forgave you 5 years ago when you came to me. I washed you and cleansed you. I don't even know what you're talking about because it's been destroyed. That record's been destroyed. You're the one that keeps bringing it up. It's over. You're forgiven. And God's saying, let it go because I already forgave you. Now you need to forgive yourself. So we have a tendency in our time with him to go back and relive things. And it's like, and then we go to the Lord and say, oh, God, forgive me. Oh, God, I'm so sorry. And God says, no, I heard you the first time. Now turn around and move forward and stop going back there. Amen. Because by doing so, when we keep looking back, it'll steal our future. It'll steal our destiny. It'll steal our greatness. Because the past will hold us hostage and take away our future. So he says, this is how you pray. Give us today our daily bread. And in the future, it's not here. So there's a vision. There's things that God has put on our heart. But there's a lot of things that God has put on my heart from years ago that are taking place today, and God's still doing it. But the way I thought it was going to be done, it's completely opposite of the way it's being done. Lord, use us to reach millions. Well, we're reaching the world in a lot of different ways. So he's doing it. But I didn't know we're going to be here as a foundation in the inner city. When they told us about this church, I didn't even know where it was at. God had a different plan on how to fulfill that vision. So what I'm saying is you hold on to it and you make yourself available to the future, but then you let it go because tomorrow's not here. Because you can be so caught up with that and your scenarios of how God's going to do it all and how it's going to happen and how it's going to take place that you miss today's miracle. You miss today's word. You miss today's instruction because today's instruction is going to help you go into tomorrow's miracle. You miss today being a blessing. Hearing his voice today because I'm so caught up with yesterday. I'm so caught up with tomorrow. And God's saying, we don't even know if tomorrow is going to, he might come. We don't know if Jesus comes back tomorrow. But somebody needs Jesus today. Someone needs to hear a word today. Someone needs encouragement today. Somebody needs to make a big decision today. And God wants to speak to us today to help us with tomorrow. So he says, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad. That's a great prayer. So what he's basically saying is, let go of the past, hold on to the future, but don't go into it because it's not here yet, and make today great. Be the greatest champion you can be for me today. Live for me today. Live today like it's the last day. Pray a prayer. So Lord, give me today, and it's in the there's a verse here that's in scripture. Give me what I need today. Don't give me too much, because it talks about it. If God gives us too much, we might have a tendency to walk away from him. How many of us have prayed, God, I answered the prayer, and then we forget the one that answered the prayer? You cried, you pressed in, you came to church faithfully for weeks and weeks and months, and then God turned everything around, you got healthier, you got stronger, things started to get back into place, and then all of a sudden, where you at? So many people in this church touched miracles in this house. And then all of a sudden, they just kind of disappear. And some come back later in worse condition than they were the first time. Oh, my God, I'm saying something. After a great victory and God answers, we don't pray less, we don't worship less, we don't serve less. We should serve more, pray more, and worship more. It should cause us, because of his goodness and mercy and how much he loves us, how much he's done for us, to do more, to press in more, to hunger for more. And then, Lord, don't give me not enough. Where I have to go break into someone's house so I can get some food. That's scripture. There's some scripture on that. So what I'm saying, what a great prayer. Lord, give me what I need today. What a great prayer, huh? Lord, today for my family. Today for my children. Today for my household. Today for the assignment. Today, whatever I need today that you called me to fulfill and accomplish, I'm willing, I'm available. Your will to be done, not my will to be done. So give me the provision that I need today so I can be successful on the mission you have for me today. Let me just finish with this. There's a lot more. Maybe by the grace of God, when I get back, if God's directing me, I'm going to pick this up. Is that all right? Is this, are you happy you're here?
Yes,
this is, when you come, here it is, and I talked about the list, and then God spoke in my heart last night, and I spoke, watch it. Here's what we do too. See, there's some lists that we have that are good. There's nothing wrong with them. God says, pray, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and shall be open. He says that. Now, I'm talking about people that really want to go to the next level. I'm talking about people that want to be the soldiers that God's called them to be. I'm talking about people. I'm talking to people here today that want to be mature in the things of God. Is that you? Because if not, then I won't give it to you. You can't. Then you don't need this then. This is for somebody that wants to go to the next level. This is the next level. We're not talking when you first get saved. No. So he says, pray. And we know there's power in prayer, but watch it. But God wants us to get to a place where, watch this, you can have a list, and the list can be God, scripture, things from the Word. They're good intentions. But when you have a list, and you stick to that list, we limit God, and God's going to say, okay, you want to stick to that list? I'll give you that. But guess what? I had this for you. Here's your list. I haven't responded because what I'm trying to do is get you to a place and a time so you can hear from me. And start to get to a place where you're living day by day, not my will, but your will to be done. Whatever you have for me today, you know best. But God says, you keep on bringing this list, so I'll give you some of that list. But guess what? I had so much more than that list. We limit God when we're stuck with our list. God's saying, get rid of your list, because what I have on my list for you is far greater than the list you have. That's a word. So like I said last night, I've come to a place, the things I thought I knew about, ministry, things of God, the church, the assignment, I've come to a place here the last 3-4 years, I don't know nothing. Praise the Lord. What did you learn at church? Pastor said he doesn't know nothing. The things I thought I knew and all the things and all the craziness about ministry and things and stuff and what. And I've realized I'm just now starting to learn what it's all about. And now I'm at a place by the grace of God. And things are starting to happen that I had no idea or understanding, but now I've come to a place where, Lord, I am open to whatever you want. Whatever you want this to be. However you want this to be done. Even if I don't understand it, I'm going to trust you that you're going to bring the people and the help and the resources. But whatever you want and however you want to do this, I am open to it. So now it's like day by day. So even right now, as I'm leaving for India, I said this last night, I had to stop myself from thinking about the trip and the services and the plane, all of it. You know, because my mind was racing. Okay, well, when I get there, where am I going to be staying? What are the services? Where is it at? How close to pack? Anyway, I don't get into all that. You don't want to get into that part of my brain. You thought I was like, praise the Lord, hallelujah. Going to the other side of the world. I got a wife. I got a child. I got a church. I got responsibilities. But I got a family also. I got a mother. I got a father. And I'm going to the other side of the world. Anyway, so I deal with stuff. And I'm not 20 years old. And these trips cost you something. But I had to stop. Say, that's not here yet. Now that's where I'm going. Praise the Lord if that's where God wants me to go. If he wants to stop it, he'll stop it somehow. But I'm willing to the best of my ability because this is where I'm supposed to go. But what God's leading, what the church that we have and everything. But I got to focus on today. Because right now, if I'm thinking about tomorrow or the week of and the ministry of in India, I wouldn't be here right now ministering to you with all my heart and what God has for you. So what good is it? I'm thinking about something from a week from now or tomorrow, the next couple days. And God's saying, I have called you today to bring hope, encouragement, to speak my word, to make the crooked places straight, to speak my word, to bring hope and encouragement and salvation, to encourage the people to come closer to me. And you're thinking about next week. And what about right now and the people here? The miracle of today. The miracle of right now. So I shut that down by the grace of God. And I'm here. I'm all here right now. And I'm not giving you leftovers. I'm not giving you my second best. I'm giving you everything. I start thinking, my wife knows, she'll tell you, I've been struggling physically, dehydrated. I even take like an IV to feel, you know, to get me hydrated again for the trip because I always get dehydrated and I go overseas. And when I go overseas, the people have been with me, I sweat. It's a challenge. I've always got to take these things to hydrate me. It's a whole process. It's a whole event to keep me hydrated. Because the first time I went overseas, I ended up in the emergency room when I came back, my first trip. I learned a lot, though. See, God used it, though. Sick for 2 years because of it. So I'm thinking about this. I'm thinking, the last couple days, I'm like, I'm not feeling good. I'm feeling tired. I'm feeling weird. I'm about to get on a plane and go overseas. That, again, you got to stay hydrated. And I'm thinking, and it's like, well, maybe you should get somebody to share the weekend. And I started thinking, well, why don't I? And I'm like, no, you know what? I'll do what I know possible with the wisdom of God. But that's not here yet. I'm going to be gone next weekend. Others are speaking. No, I'm going to speak to the people that you've called me to speak to. This is my assignment today and yesterday. Because I don't even know what tomorrow's going to bring. We might all be in heaven. Well, we might all be in heaven. Well, some of you not yet. We're going to make sure you are, though, after we pray. We'll make sure you get in today. We'll make sure the rest, just in case there's somebody in here, we'll make sure you get your passport today. His name is Jesus. Keep it simple. Because God's doing stuff in this church now that what I had put in my mind, the place that I thought we'd have a church and doing things and reaching the people and how he's doing it. And now I'm realizing, you know what? What this has become and what God wants to do with it. And I still don't see the whole thing. But this ain't anything close to what I thought. The main thing, though, was what the cry was years ago, use us to reach millions. And God says, I've heard that prayer. I have called you to reach millions. But how I'm going to do it, get rid of the list. Get out of the way. Get your mind out of the way. Because this ain't a normal church. This ain't a normal assignment. And as I'm starting to learn more and more what God's doing with this, and this is to encourage you here, if you're connected in any kind of way to fire and water, God's assignment, God's church, God's people. I believe, as someone shared a few days ago to us too, it's something that's not normal, and it's different. And religion has nothing to do with it. It's just full of relationship. It's full of love, loving people back to life. But the whole thing, the whole dynamic of it, is going to be a blueprint that others are going to look at and follow. And how God wants to do it, that's up to Him. All we've got to do is just show up every morning and be available every morning. In Jesus' name, amen? Amen. Time and a place. If it's lingered a little bit, or if you've kind of fallen away from that, be encouraged today because you're here. God's saying, get back to that time and place, because that's the key to your success. That's the key to this church. And its success, and individually for our success. And like I said before, and you got to protect it. Just like I said in Chicago, the alarm systems aren't sophisticated the way they are today with videos and things like that, and alarm systems. Back in the day when businesses closed, like there was an auto place there, a car lot, they close up the fence and they let out two German shepherds. That was security. That was the neighborhood, amen. Anybody know what I'm talking about back in the day? Yeah. So if you're walking even across the street or nearby, you don't even need to be by the fence. If you look, I remember, you look in that direction, all of a sudden those German shepherds would let you know. They'd come running to the fence, and you're not even close to the fence. You're just looking in their direction. They run to the fence, and they start to just go off. And they're letting you know, don't even think about it. We need some of that. We need to have that in the spirit when busyness, people, things around us try to get in the way of our time and our place. When something tries to get in, a phone call, a message, busy, or temptation to change your schedule, you know, you need to have a little German shepherd in you in the spirit where you're like, look at someone and go, rawr! Shout hallelujah. Lift up your hand and say, I receive it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's have the worship team come back up here. And we're going to prepare our hearts for communion. We're going to close the service with communion. We're going to close our service with communion. Also, on the way out today, we have a sign-up sheet. Remember, when we in December 7th, Saturday, we're giving out, like we did last year. Last year, we gave out 900 Christmas gifts to the community, and we're going to do it again here at the church. And if you are, and we have so many people that stepped up to help, and that's made it so successful. We're going to have two meetings coming up, and we're going to announce them. But we want to get an idea of how many people are going to be available to help on that day. So if you are available and you want to help on that day, to give out, and that's throughout the day. It's a whole event that we're doing. There's a sign-up sheet on the way out. Please let us know that you're available. And then in a few weeks from now, we're going to give you two dates, the day of and one before that, for a meeting to get together and kind of give direction of what we're going to do and how we're going to do it and where everyone's going to be. Amen? Amen? Look at someone, say, all hands on deck. Praise the Lord. That's how we accomplish greatness. Praise God. So at this time, if we can have the ushers to serve the people communion. And the Bible says to examine our hearts before we take communion. Amen. So at this time, just take some time. Look into your heart. See where you're at. And before we partake, because we do this in remembrance of him, so to partake, the requirement for partaking is to know him. So you're going to have that opportunity to say yes to him if you've never given your heart to Jesus. Amen. We do this in remembrance of what he's done in our lives and what he went through. Amen. Praise the Lord. Ushers, go ahead and serve the people.
Praise the Lord. Come on, you can do better than that. Praise the Lord, everybody. What an awesome time to come together in unity, to fellowship, and as Jesus did with his disciples, break bread. The Bible makes it very plain. He says, when you do this, do it in remembrance of me. As Pastor Gus was preaching about a place and a time, how can you remember someone that you don't know? How can you have a place and time to spend with him when you don't know who he is? So today, if it's you in this house that has not accepted Jesus as your personal Savior, right now is your place and your time. If you're here and you want to give your life to Christ, that's the only requirement is taking communion is to be saved. So if you're here and you have not accepted Jesus as your personal Savior, I would just invite you right now. Just raise your hand. Come on, if you're here, just raise your hand. And if everybody in the house is saved, that's a problem. That's a problem. If everybody is saved, then that means we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing. To be witnessing, compelling those to come. And as Pastor Gus said in the beginning, it's not a church that's a clique or a club, but it's a hospital for healing. But I do praise God that you are saved. And there might be one in the room that just doesn't want to raise their hand. So as brother and sister, we're going to say this prayer together anyway. Because the Bible says to not take communion unworthily. So sometimes we just taking it as a meal. Because that's basically what it is. If you have not accepted him as your Savior. So we're going to say this prayer together, everyone but with me. Lord Jesus, I ask you now, forgive me for all my sins. I confess with my mouth and believe with my heart that Jesus died and rose with all power so that I will have everlasting life. I ask you now to fill me with your Spirit. Be the Lord of my life and my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. For I received from the Lord when I also passed on to you. Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread. And when he'd given thanks, Lord Jesus, I thank you, Lord, for this bread that represents your body that was broken for us. God, I give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor as we partake together in the mighty name of Jesus. He broke it and said, this is my body which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. You may eat the bread. In the same manner, after they supped, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it. In remembrance of me. Father, we thank you for the blood that washes away all our sins. The blood that streamed down. The blood that when you were pierced in your side and a crown smashed on your head, the blood was rich so that I would be forgiven. And I thank you. In Jesus' name, you may drink. Amen. Truly, God is an awesome God, and it's so awesome to know that we have that place and that time in our life because he makes it for us. It's up to us to make it for him. We thank God for each and every one in the house tonight, today. And know that the assignment is for us to be a light outside of these four walls so that others will come running and say, what must I do to be saved? So when you leave this place, let your light shine. And it's not really you, but it's the light of Christ within you. Come on and stand to your feet. Let us worship one more time before we walk out the door. Father, we thank you again for this day and for this service. Lord, we pray right now in the mighty name of Jesus for the man of God that you placed over this house, preparing to take flight, to go to the other side, to do the work that you call them to do. Lord, whenever you told your disciples to go to the other side, you was with them. And Father, I believe just like you're going to be here with us on next week, you are with him in the flight and in the assignment that you have called him to. God, we thank you that you named the church Fire and Water International, because internationally, you will go abroad. And as you take the man of God, we ask for a special anointing. We ask for a special refilling in the mighty name of Jesus to equip him, empower him to take a word to the lost, to the hurting, the afflicted and the addicted across the waters. God, fill him up right now in the name of Jesus like never before. Strengthen him. Hydrate him, Lord, with your blood. Hydrate him, Lord, with your word. Strengthen him to speak under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Let your presence be made known through him as he goes and as he comes back in the mighty name of Jesus. Now take us from this place, but not your presence. Take us up and down a dangerous highway and bring us back at your appointed time to do your will and to be about your business. God, we know you make time for us, so we're going to make time for you. We're going to pick a place, and we're going to commune with you, and we're going to love you because there is none like you. We thank you. We praise you. We exalt you, and we magnify your name in the mighty name of Jesus. Let the church say, amen. God bless you.